Hi guys, so glad to have you all here for the session today. Today's topic that we've picked up at Modish Social Connections is a very important one, and I'm sure like all the other mothers like me would agree to it that this is one of the it's been one of the most concerning topics for us, that how can we prevent COVID and its symptoms for our little ones. So I have I have Dr. Nitin Verma here, who is an industry expert, and he is going to be giving us tips on how to protect our little ones from this deadly virus. And very soon he'll be joining the video and answering all your concerns. I think he's already here for the video. Yes. Hi, Dr. Verma. How are you? Good evening.
Hi, Priyanka. How are you doing? I'm well.
I'm Karishma. Yeah. I'm doing well as well. And I'm really, really thankful that you've decided to become a part of this discussion. Being a mother myself, I've been really, really concerned about the well-being of my kids. And I have so many people here who've joined us, and they are exactly in the same way concerned about the well-being of their kids. And we are really lost amongst our own stress points, and we don't know how to take care of the little ones. I have an 8-month-old daughter, and there are so many others here who have just had their babies. So I would really want you to guide us with a few topics and tips on how we can protect our kids from this deadly virus.
Happy to help. So let's start with a small preamble. What is it that, you know, everything is all about COVID-19. You know, you're flooded it on media, you open the news, you open Twitter, Instagram, WhatsApp, you get only forwards about COVID.
Exactly.
Is it a bad disease? Yes, it's a bad disease. Is it really as bad as it's made out to be? No, it's pretty much like the flu which we get. However, there are some lacunae. The lacunae are, one, it's a new disease, so our understanding about the disease is not as much as the understanding of other diseases.
Exactly.
Two, don't have standardized protocols as yet. So, you know, the cases started coming in December, and the experience of the world is 3 to 4 months. So different protocols are being tried. They're being tried in mild cases, in moderate cases, yeah, in severe cases. And as yet, there is no hard and fast rule like we have, say, for swine flu. We've been living with it for so many years. We have a vaccine against
exactly.
it. We're not scared if we get it, because even if we do, we know how to diagnose it. Know what the symptoms are, there's a cure for it.
Yeah.
And because we don't have a standardized cure, and we haven't reached, or we are just about reaching where it's going to go in a community spread, we need to be extremely careful. Who are the vulnerable people? The vulnerable people are elders, those over 65, those with comorbidities, you know, with conditions like diabetes, heart and hypertension, pregnant women, we'll probably deal with that a little later, and children below 10. Fortunately,
children below 10.
Yeah, so fortunately, pretty mild disease in children, but as I said, only a handful of cases treated, getting a lot of literature from around the world of different complications which happen when children get it. So, till such time as we have standardized. So you get a pneumonia, bad disease, but we know how to treat it. There are standardized protocols. Till
exactly.
this happens, or a vaccine comes, which we'll discuss again later, we need to prevent it. How do you prevent it? Three simple things. One,
okay.
Washing. Cannot stress it enough. Don't touch things. If I'm talking, I mustn't reach out and touch my face, my nose. So, hand washing. Wash your hands, don't be in a hurry. Wash for about 20 seconds. Two, wear a mask. If I meet you, Karishma, and both of us are wearing a mask, the chance of one of us infecting the other is minuscule. Three.
All right.
Yeah. And third is social distance. So try and avoid people unless it's required. how can your child get, your child does not go out, the schools are closed. In your case, you have a young baby, 8 months old. The only way your baby can get it is if you get it. So if you prevent it to yourself, then you prevent it for your baby. The other important dynamic in Indian families is that we have more than one generation which looks. So you're young, you may get a mild case, you have a young baby, you probably have parents and grandparents who are at a vulnerable age. Have to learn to protect them. It's pretty simple. I'm glad that we are all scared about it. I'm glad that we are talking about it. But we should understand how we can prevent. If we get symptoms, how to diagnose, and is there a treatment protocol, what should we do? We'll probably discuss that across.
I think your voice is breaking a little bit. Can everyone hear the break, or it's only me? I just wanted to ask everyone. It's just breaking a little bit in between. So we'll just start again. All right. So we can obviously not undermine the importance of all these precautions that you've suggested. And we, if we follow it, we can obviously protect our kids. So the first thing is to protect ourselves, and then we can protect our kids, right? That's exactly what we were at. Okay, so now coming to a set of questions that we've prepared for you. I'll start with something so basically earlier there were reports that the virus was not really affecting really young children. And now they are saying that it does. So there is like a generalized fear and anxiety around it. And what are your thoughts on this peculiar situation with kids? Like, is it possible that virus wasn't attacking the kids before and now it's mutating into something else and now it has started attacking the little ones?
So again, as I said, one of the many things that gets spread is not true. There were very few cases, right? Even if you look at India today, you have 90,000 positive cases who have been tested. So obviously, as more and more cases come, and you know, then the more vulnerable people start getting affected. It's not that children were not affected, but it's just that we tend to shield children more. And therefore, there were not very many cases. The fallout is also that thankfully, children tend to get. Not that they will always get, they tend to get mild cases. So there is a chance that if you have COVID in a child, it's likely to be mild. We have an experience of a lot of children, you know, the biggest study that we have access to is coming from the United States of America, where they've had maybe about 14 and a half to 15 lakh cases. So there are about more than 100,000 cases in children. The most vulnerable group where children got it were over 10. So 11 to 15 and then bigger children. Obviously, because these are children who went out and met people. Yeah. 90% of children who got COVID got it because one of their family members got it. Very important fact. Remember, so that if we put COVID to ourselves, then our child will not get COVID. We look at that, you suddenly start wondering what has happened. Why are people not falling ill? Why are children not falling ill as much? Of course, this is a better season because of temperatures, certain illnesses come, and two schools are closed. And that's how illness spreads. So if so what are we doing? Social distancing. If all children were to go back to school, there would be a huge surge. Why is government closing malls, cinema halls? These are places where people congregate together. So if we can if we can stay away, we can prevent. So coming back to children, there are cases in children below 10 as well. Most of them are mild. The severe cases can happen if you get COVID below 1 year of age. Why is it severe? Okay. It's severe because obviously the lungs are immature. We know that it attacks the respiratory system. You don't have nerves and they are not well developed. The immunity of the baby is not well developed. And therefore, there is a chance of having more severe cases in young children. Fortunately, as I said, really, really, the children seem to be spared as compared to the adults at the moment.
Okay. So the symptoms are comparatively mild in kids below 10. So
it's pretty much like the normal flu. Okay. All 80% of cases are asymptomatic, which means there is a member in your house who's got COVID and you don't know about it because he or she has no symptom. So 80% will have no or mild symptom, just a mild cold cough. In more severe cases, cold cough, fever, difficulty in breathing, and off late we are finding gastrointestinal symptoms, which means you may be having vomiting and loose motions. Then come things like a little bit of chest pain and difficulty in breathing. Obviously, because we are now aware and we look out for it, we are on the alert and we think of COVID as one of the diagnoses which has come. You'll be surprised to know that, you know, you would have read about different protocols coming in from government and people being screened if you come for any illness. It's surprising. Yeah. A 70-year-old person comes in with a heart attack. He's treated, he recovers. Suddenly he develops fever and you find he's COVID positive. So COVID may actually trigger other abnormalities. So it's not a bad idea, whatever the illness is. If it's a febrile illness, if you have fever, you should always think in terms of COVID. What is the reason why you must screen? What? You have another condition that you go for, and the stress of that illness converts a mild COVID into a severe COVID. That's the reason about screening. Pregnant women are all being screened for COVID. We'll probably deal with that later. I'm sure you'll have a question.
Yes. We have a whole section on pregnant women and COVID. Yeah.
All right.
Yeah. So one of the questions that I'm constantly getting here before I skip them is the immunity boosting food for kids. So like newborns who've just started eating and the other kids, what are the immunity boosting foods for them which can protect them?
So, you know, this is so everybody has a suggestion. Everybody's a doctor, you know, from you to the maid, to the son who comes in. So there are homeopathic cures. How can you have a homeopathic cure when the disease is, nobody is treated? It's, we are scientists. So we do know that immunity comes from eating a balanced diet. Why do babies don't get? Babies don't get because by the time their mother gets it, the mother is producing antibodies called IgG. And this is secreted in breast milk. So the mother who's feeding her baby is already protecting her baby. So if we get cases where, and we are getting a few cases where the mother has a baby, we encourage them to continue feeding with prevention of using masks or by expressing and feeding, because the baby is actually getting immunity. How do we give immunity to children? So immunity comes from eating a balanced diet. It's false that if you have extra vitamin C or zinc, then you won't get it. These are important elements in any person's diet. There is a trade-off between you're taking a synthetic vitamin vis-a-vis getting it from natural sources. So if we eat a balanced diet, which all of us are, there's no food coming in from Zomato anymore, right? So we are not cooking. So it's healthy food. So think of a simple thing. So if you're having a little bit of dal, you're taking protein, you're having rice, you're having carbohydrate, the little bit of oil or desi ghee you put in gives you fat, the vegetable gives you minerals. Try and take fresh fruit. So fresh fruit juice or fresh juice are excellent sources of vitamin C. Vitamin C is a natural antioxidant. So if you do get it, it will help you fight it. So my answer is very simple. You don't need to take an extra protein. Just try and keep it simple. Eat fresh home-cooked food. Eat regularly. Maintain hygiene. You will have good immunity.
All right. So for those who could not hear it because of the voice crack, Dr. Verma here is suggesting that if we eat home-cooked food with proper hygiene measures, we can boost our immunity automatically. So that's going to help us keep safe. I'm getting a lot of questions regarding the immunization and vaccination. So I have a whole section on that. You guys stay tuned. And I'm sure Dr. Verma is going to help you all. Okay, so I'll come to the vaccinations question first because so many people have said that. So vaccinations are a big concern for parents because the general immunizations, not the COVID vaccine. So could you please suggest us a way forward for the following categories of kids, like 0 to 1 year old kids? Can they delay their vaccinations? And if they can, for how long can they delay it?
Okay, so let's divide up vaccines into three distinct groups. 0 to 1 year. Okay. 1 to 2 years and more than
yeah.
Even more than two, we can break into 2 to 5 and then children over 5. So the vaccines in the age group birth 1 year are extremely
sorry, I missed you there.
And you know, you should do it. I'll tell you how to do it.
Yeah.
So the first vaccines are given at the place where the mother is born. So you don't have to worry about it. Wherever the birthing takes place, the first dose of BCG polio drops will be given there. Wherever you, the baby is born, right?
So, yeah.
So that vaccine is given. Then there are a set of 3 vaccines given in the first 6 months. These are combination vaccines. The first vaccine is a combination of Hib, DPT, and polio. You need 3 doses before 6 months of age. The second is the pneumonia vaccine. You need, again, 3 vaccines before 6 months of age. And the last are drops and diarrhea, rotavirus diarrhea. Again, 3 doses. You have combination vaccines. So you actually need to visit the clinic or the doctor only 3 times in the first 6 months. You have a gap that you may delay it a little bit. The ideal gap is 4 to 6 weeks. So you may delay it by up to 4 weeks, but not more than that. Having said that...
So not more than 4 weeks.
No. Having said that, how do you do? What should I do? I have a 3-month baby. His vaccine is due. Is it safe to go to the hospital? The following things need to be done both by you and your doctor. So what should you be checking? What you should be checking that the place where the vaccination is taking place, whether it is the hospital...
Can you come again, Dr. Verma? I think your voice just dropped there.
Yeah, sure. So you have to check that the place where your baby is being vaccinated, whether it's a clinic or the hospital, has a separate area for vaccination where nobody else except those coming for vaccines are allowed. Number one. Number two, from the hospital side or the clinic side, precautions are being taken. What are these precautions? A, there is adequate airflow. 2, there is no waiting. So when you go in with your baby, there is nobody else who's there except the doctor, the assistant, and you. 3, the doctor and his assistant are wearing a mask, a gown, and gloves. Number 4, you yourself are wearing gloves and a mask. Number 5, you are sanitizing when you go in. Number 6, there is minimum touch. I would encourage you to take the weight of your baby in the house so that you go in, get the vaccines, and move out. Thereafter, do either a voice call or a video consult with your pediatrician and cover the point. So if you minimize the amount of contact, then your child is going to be absolutely safe. And lastly, make sure that in the area of vaccine, after you have moved out, the area is sanitized before the next baby comes in. This is something which I practice both in my immunization in my clinic and in my hospital. So the area nobody, so if somebody comes in with cold and cough, cannot enter into that area. You come in one by one. You go in the doctor's chamber. You're wearing a mask. The doctor's wearing a mask. The doctor's wearing a shield. You don't infect the doctor. The doctor and the other people don't infect you. As I said, the scare is asymptomatic cases. Take your vaccine and move out quickly. So this is for the vaccines in the first 6 months of life. After 6 months, between 6 months and 9 months, there are 3 vaccines. The flu vaccine, the typhoid vaccine, and the MMR vaccine.
Yes. I have questions regarding that. Yeah.
So these are important. But if you feel, depending on what the situation is at that time, you could delay it by up to a month. You have to be smart. At the moment, situation is fine. What happens tomorrow once the lockdown opens and there are more cases? So it's a question of being smart, planning. Can I do it now quickly and get out so that then I don't have anything to do for the next 3 months? So think, be open, discuss with your doctor, discuss with your family members as well. But
yeah.
at the end, you have to make wise choices. The vaccines after between 1 year and 2 years are MMR, chickenpox, hepatitis A, and boosters. We can delay this. Not indefinitely. But if a 1 year vaccine...
Sorry, I lost you there. So how long can we delay the 1 year to 2 year vaccine?
So you can delay it by 1 to 2 months.
Okay.
Why can we delay them? Delay them because our child is homebound and so is unlikely to pick up a disease. Because if he was going to school, then I wouldn't delay them. So the vaccines after 1 year, you can delay for a bit. The vaccines after 2 years of age are based on boosters. Your child has already can be delayed by 3 to 6 months.
Sorry, doctor, we lost you there. Actually, I've been getting comments. Your voice is breaking, so I'll just repeat it for everyone. If your child is younger than 1 year, you can delay the vaccination for up to 4 weeks and not more than that.
Yes.
And you have to take care of everything that's happening in the vaccination center. Everything should be sanitized. The doctor should be completely covered. You should be completely covered. And you should always carry a bottle of sanitizer with you and avoid touching any surfaces that might infect. And for 1 year to 2 years, Dr. Verma is suggesting that we can delay the vaccination by 1 to 2 months.
That's right.
Yeah.
So it's a question of being smart and doing things the correct way. And I would encourage you to discuss with your doctor that, you know, be honest, say, I'm scared to come. How can you help me? Obviously, nobody can come and give the vaccine to you. You will have to go to a center, but you have to find the best time to go, the best place to go, where best practices are being followed. That's very important.
Yeah. Doctor, we have quite a few people who are asking if their kids are elder than 2 years and 3.5 years and 4 years old, what about their flu shots?
So as I can see a few of my patients who've logged in as well and are asking questions. So great. I don't have to.
Yeah, we have quite a few people who are your patients here. Yeah.
Individually. So as I said, the flu vaccine is a vaccine which is given once a year. Okay, the ideal time to give the flu vaccine is, there are two peaks. One is pre-monsoon, which is now, and the second is in winter. But if your child has had the flu vaccine the previous year, there will be some protection. The immunity tends to go down after 9 months. So it's important, but it can wait. Why is it important to take? Because one flu will lower your immunity and make you more prone to develop the second flu. So find a window, but there is no emergency to rush and take the flu vaccine.
Okay, so there is no such emergency. If within the last 9 months you've got the vaccination done, you can wait for another.
Yes.
Yeah. All right. So, doctor, how serious do you think are the symptoms of COVID in young kids and infants?
So, as I said, It's something which even the doctors are still learning about, right? So it's not like a malaria or a typhoid or even a complicated disease like Kawasaki all the time. It's something that as we see more and more and we take from the experience of the virus in different countries, then you tend to learn. We are following protocols. These protocols work. Most of the protocols are for adults because children don't get it so much. But we have standardized protocols in place. So, as I said, it's by and large a mild disease. So,
yeah.
We keep our fingers crossed and hope that too many children don't get it. If we are careful, then too many children will not get it.
So the onus of it lies on us. Like the more cautious we are, we are more able to protect our kids from the deadly virus. Yeah. So the vaccination for COVID has apparently reached the trial stage, but it doesn't seem to be reaching us for the next year probably. So how long do you think it will take for the researchers to come out with a vaccine? And will this vaccine be safe for kids and newborn?
So... Honestly, your guess is as good as mine, but I'll tell you what information is available. the normal the coronavirus is a virus that we've been dealing with for many years, not this strain of coronavirus, and okay. we've never been able to form a vaccine. The flu vaccine has never covered things like the respiratory syncytial virus, which causes more flu than the other strains of the flu vaccine or the coronavirus. Different countries are in different stages. There is a process, and the earliest where we are going, you'll be pleased to know, is actually in India. And this is a vaccine which is being developed by Serum Institute of India, the Poonawalla
Group.
And they've gone one step ahead, which only an Indian can do. They've started manufacturing the vaccine. Why? They said if it doesn't work, we'll throw it. But if it works and we can do it, then we have the vaccine. The process of testing it in humans is a very...
Sorry, I lost you there again. Can you please come back again, doctor?
Yeah, the process of testing vaccine is a long-drawn process. You may test it on 200, 250, 300, 500 volunteers, but you don't know what the efficacy of the vaccine is. Obviously, it is tested on adults and not tested in children. So we won't really know what the efficacy in young children is. And the last and most important thing is that any virus tends to mutate over a period of time. Take the example of swine flu. From the time that we first started treating swine flu about 10 years back, the virus has mutated 4 times. So even the strain of swine flu that we give today is different from the swine flu strain that I used 6 months back. So it's a matter of texture. The last thing to think, how many doses will a vaccine company produce? 1 million? 2 million? What is the population of India? 130 crores, right?
Yeah, exactly.
How many doses will India get? Will there be arm twisting and USA get the doses earlier? Yes. So the Sanofi vaccine, which is being formed, the company is based in France. They've already placed the first doses to America because that's where the funding and the money comes in from. So
exactly.
we would be lucky if we have a vaccine for mass distribution before a year. Yes, a vaccine will come. We won't know how safe it is, and perhaps it will be used for senior citizens and healthcare workers. And based on what the response is, it will then go on for sale for more and more people. So let's not pin our hopes on that.
Hopes on that.
It is still a mild disease. The fact that 80% of people can have symptomatic disease and get, let's just try and prevent the vulnerable people, the children and the grandparents. Protect them. Don't let your father-in-law go out even if he wants to. Say, I'm sorry. I'll play a movie on Netflix or Amazon Prime for you. If you prevented these people, then gradually as disease protocols, treatment protocols come, vaccines come, more understanding of treatment, it'll become easier disease to handle.
Yeah, I think I lost you there for a few seconds, but we've more or less got the point of what you were talking about. I have quite a few questions there which I would like you to answer.
Yes.
Don't listen to you if they're moving out or husband may have.
So I'm losing your picture. If you could just repeat the question again. No, if you could repeat the question,
can
please.
You hear me? Can you hear me now? Can you hear me now?
Yes, I can hear you now. Yeah.
Yeah. So what are the precautions that can be taken when you have a newborn back home, as elders don't listen if they're moving out or your husband may have work to move out for?
Well, it's... somebody has to listen, right? And what you need to understand is, let me start by giving an example of what I do. If I have to go to the hospital, and I have a 90-year-old mother who lives in my house. So obviously She's vulnerable. I take exactly. all precautions when I go. My car is driven by me. Yeah. I don't. My driver is on paid leave. I park it myself. No valet is given the car. I gown myself when I go to the hospital, so that yeah. I'm wearing a gown. I'm wearing gloves. I'm wearing a cap. I'm wearing a shield so that I protect myself. I sanitize before I come. Once I come home, I take my shoes out outside the house. I walk in straight to my toilet. I have a bath. I sanitize myself and I put all the clothes that I wear in a bucket of boiling hot water. Only then I go and I maintain a distance from the other people in the house. Now a newborn is vulnerable, and your husband must realize, as must your father-in-law, that you, if you stay alive, you will earn after 2 months also. It's very important to, it's very, very important to, you know, save the people who are vulnerable, and a newborn is vulnerable. So there are healthcare workers who move to a separate room. They don't live with their families. So if in the worst case scenario, then the father-in-law and the husband should isolate in a different part of the house. If they can't, it's important, and not in come in contact with the newborn. You have to prevent. We don't have as much testing. And how much can you test? You may be positive, but test positive after 7 days. You may have already passed it on to the others. So you have to prevent. Let's not reach a stage where we try and treat. Let's try and prevent.
Exactly. So prevention is better than cure.
Yes.
Anytime. Yeah. Yes. So recently in the news, New York has reported a rare syndrome in COVID-19 positive kids. Should we be worried about that?
This syndrome is due to a surge which can happen after any viral illness. It's called Kawasaki disease. Something which to work in tertiary care hospitals see a lot. So I would probably diagnose and treat at least 1 to 2 cases of Kawasaki a month. But that's because I have worked in, you know, in hospitals which are referral centers. So it's something that we are aware of. It's something that we watch out for. But this is only emerging. They've had a study of about 50 to 100 cases who presented with illnesses. We are aware of it. The medical fraternity in India is aware of it. And we look out for it if we were to treat a case with COVID. Fortunately, treating COVID is confined to certain hospitals. Everybody is not going to treat COVID. You will have to go if you are admitted to a select few government or private hospitals. And because they deal only with COVID, they have an experience of what to manage and standardized protocols of what to look out for and what to do.
All right. I'll just take a few questions which I missed due to bad connection. All right. So the side effects of the vaccination for kids, I think we've already answered that it'll, once it's out, we'll get to know more about it. Is there any provision of kids who are positive, like separate nursery to take care of children who are infected by COVID-19?
So obviously, management is divided into mild, moderate, severe. Mild cases can either be self-quarantined and observed as long as there is a medical professional who's observing, or they go into primary care centers where they are managed by looking at their symptoms, their oxygen saturation, and waiting for it to turn severe. If it is mild, we just observe and give basic management. In severe cases, there are standardized protocols, you know, based on what the oxygen concentration is, what the X-ray findings are, on a standardized list of drugs which are started, depending on the condition. And then, of course, we monitor and we may escalate or move down. There are some experimental protocols which are coming in. You would have heard of things like plasma therapy, that is giving plasma.
Yes, I have.
These are still in the development stage. So it's not something which some cases have tried it, but it's very difficult to say whether it will work based on a study of 10 cases or 20 cases. There are also antiviral drugs which are being used extensively in America with promising results. And there are some results coming in from Israel of some monoclonal antibodies which are showing promising results. But as yet, nothing concrete. So we stay on the gold standard of basic management of symptoms and antiviral drugs.
All right. Okay, that was very, very informative. I hope you got your answer. Arshia here is asking, the children keep getting cold and cough back and forth even after giving medicine for a week. So can only steam help?
Yes, of course you can. So, you know, one of the things doing the round on the internet is that if you take hot water, I was seeing some people saying, or steam, that is based on two facts. Now, the virus stays alive for different times on different surfaces. So whether it's in the respiratory tract, where obviously, you know, it's ideal for it because of high, you know, the conditions in which it can survive, and then on different surfaces. And we know that heat tends to kill the vaccine. So
heat tends to kill.
So over us. So one of the ways of sanitizing, how do I sanitize my mask? I have labeled it Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, Saturday. And so I come and I take it off and it's just kept outside. I can keep it in an oven or I can put it in ultraviolet. And when I don't wear it for 6 days, it sanitizes by itself. Till I, you know, move on to the next set of masks which I use. So heat and high humidity decreases the amount of time that the virus stays alive. So technically, it would help. But let's just stay with three basic things. I've said it earlier, I repeat it again. Hand washing. Using a mask if you must go out. And social distancing. If you do these three things, then there's a over 90% chance that you'll be safe and you won't get the disease. If you have to go out, and you have to go out for work. Because, you know, at the end, we don't know what is the end of this disease. At some stage, work will have to resume. You have to change. What has happened now in the last 2 months? Our lifestyle has changed. There's no food being ordered. You're not going to the nice 4.8 rating restaurant to eat. But we're okay. We are still eating well. We are falling ill less. There is less stress. The family is bonding together. The child gets to see the father. Brilliant, right? He has time for
Exactly. So for children, it's the best time ever.
Absolutely. However, it can get stressful for children. Not everybody stays on a farm or, you know, in a house where there's space. There are people living in apartments. So you have to plan activities. Just as you do when you have 7 days in Greece or on a holiday, you plan activity and do it in a way that you make it fun for the children. Try and avoid too much of screen, because we don't want to survive that and end up with you know, other issues related to extra time with screen. Try and spend quality time together. What do I do when I'm sitting in the evening and my daughter and son-in-law have finished their online work? We play board games. So, you know, try and do things which are fun and which keep us together and keep us fit till we have some possible cure and we can move forward with COVID. We have to live with it and we have to learn to live with it well.
Those are some really helpful tips there. So Chandra Balapati Branyam is saying, my child is teething and puts almost everything in his mouth. Finding it practically difficult to prevent him from doing it. He doesn't use his teeth. Any tips on how biting and licking can be prevented?
So, you know, the two greatest Indian obsessions, teething and constipation. So, have problems. And we make too much out of it also, because everybody, you have fever, so the mother-in-law says, ye teething ki wajah se. You have loose motion, it's because of teething. So babies have a natural mouthing reflex, and that they will put things to the mouth, and that's fine.
Yeah. Do
it. They were doing it even before COVID came, and as the teething happens, they feel very itchy in the gums, and they feel relieved when they bite. So what will we do? You can't prevent the child from doing that. Give the child good options. Put a boiled carrot in a net and give it. Or, you know, put a apple in a net and give it. Let the child bite. Just have clean surroundings for where the child is. So I'd have a nice rubberized mat on which I put the child. And I put a set of clean toys. Let him bite it. Let him bite his own hand. It's fine.
Yeah.
It's fine. So this is a natural process. You know, children teeth the world over, but in India, they seem to have more problems. We have to move forward being as careful as we can.
So our duty as parents is to give them clean things and then we can let them chew or do whatever.
That's right.
Yeah. So Aditi here is asking, would you have any suggestions for use of sanitizers among young kids? For example, a 9-year-old, they are now beginning to see sanitizing as a substitute to washing hands.
So, you know, we live in a world where there is very little that we can give to our children, right? And the most important thing that you can give in Hindi is called sanskar. So you have to teach them. So can they use a sanitizer? Yes. Can it be used to in place of washing hands? No. But if they see their parents washing hands before meals, if they see their parents washing hands all the time, they will do the same. You're on a phone and looking at your WhatsApp and you tell the child, no, no, why are you on the phone? No, you have to practice what you
speak. Exactly.
If you can do that, then of course, you know, there'll be times when he goes out when he can't wash his hands all the time. We'll teach him hand hygiene. We'll teach him to use a sanitizer. But then obviously you need to be careful. A 9-year-old can understand. So a sanitizer is not a substitute to hand washing, but it can be used. So it is the onus is on us to teach the child the correct thing. Practice. So everybody, it's dinner time. Let's all go. We'll start with Dada, Dadi, and everybody will stand in a line and wash their hands. It's a fun activity. Everybody
it
does.
Is, yeah. So that's another very good suggestion by Dr. Verma. Coming to a very important topic, because we are just left with 17 minutes of the session, pregnancy and COVID-19. So when you use these two terms together, it obviously gives you chills because you can't have a pregnant woman going through COVID-19. So do you think the baby in the mother's womb can get affected by COVID-19 if the mother has the symptoms?
So again, the third set of people who are vulnerable after children and adults is pregnant women, which is why today every woman in her pregnancy is given the flu vaccine. Why is she given the flu vaccine? Because she's vulnerable against the flu.
Exactly.
The disease is only, our experience is about 4 to 5 months with it. So we really don't know everything that happens. We only know of what happened when a mother got COVID in the last 2 months, 3 months. And we know that by and large, the fetus doesn't get affected in the last 3 months. So there are chances that there could be vertical spread. Vertical spread is from the mother to the baby. So there are chances of spread from the mother to the baby through the placenta. But once the baby is born, the baby starts getting immunity from the immunity which is built in the mother through breast milk, as I had said earlier. So if you have a mother who's COVID positive, she must continue to breastfeed. There are no indications which say that she should not breastfeed. So what you should do is you must try COVID in a pregnant woman. Where can she get it? She can get it from visits to her doctor.
Exactly.
Not meant to go out. So she must follow the same rules that he said for taking a child for the vaccine. So you must discuss with your gynecologist, have dedicated appointments, try and move forward, try and move to video conferencing. So there are things which can't be done on a video. The baby needs to be examined. An ultrasound needs to
be examined.
And in a hygienic way where everybody is safe. Remember, it's not just the pregnant woman who can get it. If she has it, the doctor can get it too. So we have to protect everybody. We have to protect everybody. Minimize the number of visits to a bare minimum. Learn to discuss things with your doctor on a video conference. You don't have to run for small things to the doctor. Try and minimize the number of visits that you do where the blood pressure of the person, you know, the screening of how the baby is doing, the growth. The scans are very, very important. They tell you whether the baby is growing well. Are there any problems with the baby's heart? You know, how's the baby growing? Should we go ahead with the pregnancy? So this is important, but it needs to be minimized to the bare number
minimum. All right. So I hope that has helped all the pregnant women out there. I am due this month. Can you please tell me about it? So Priyanka here is asking that she is due this month. And if you could suggest a few precautions that can be taken once the baby comes home.
Once the baby, so I'll answer it in two words. Once the baby comes home, stay home. It's as simple as that. So
exactly.
If you remember the good old days, you know, many of the grandma tales are correct. You didn't go out for 40 days. Why?
40 days, yeah.
Fortunately, the first vaccine is not for 6 to 8 weeks. So you don't need to go out for the baby's sake. So try and minimize going. There would be one visit probably for a check of a jaundice. Try and combine that with your gynae visit so that in one visit, both you and the baby, try and take an attendant along with you. So you don't need to wait in the pediatrician's chamber and the baby doesn't need to wait when you're going to your gynecologist for a checkup. The grandmother can take the baby and whisk the baby away and sit in the car with the AC on and the mother can visit. So try and minimize your visits. Stay home, eat healthy food, sanitize and make sure that you stay away from other people. Minimize contact with people. Don't have a maid who's coming in from outside. You shouldn't have a driver who's coming in. You must have only people who are living in the house. So if you're that I'm going to keep a japa or a nurse for my baby, bring her in 15 days before you go. So the period is over and she's safe with you. So you have to be smart. Don't think that I'll get a nurse when the baby comes. No, she needs to come in 2 weeks before. Let her sit and twiddle her thumbs. It's all right. But create an environment. It's just as you do when you plan a trip. That, you know, you pack, you plan your expenses, you plan your health care. Plan in advance. You know what needs to be done. Be smart. Talk to your gynecologist where she's delivering you, which hospital. What precautions are they taking? Try and choose, you know, exclusive birthing centers. Yeah. If you're in a multi-speciality hospital, make sure that if they have COVID, it's in a different area. It's in a different wing so that you don't get infected. Make sure the hospital practices safe medicine. It's your right to know it. Discuss it openly. Nicely, of course, but discuss it so that you know what precautions are you going to take. Who all is going to come to my room when I'm in the room for 2 days with my baby? Will the doctor be wearing a kit and a gown to protect himself and to protect me? What should I do? So these are things to note down. And have your set of questions ready. There's no point going, meeting your doctor and coming and say, oh my God, I forgot question 1, 2, and 3. Just write it down on your phone. Click a picture of it and learn to discuss everything.
Yeah. So the key is to discuss everything. I hope you got your answer, Priyanka. Doctor, like a newborn is born in a hospital and hospitals aren't exactly the place to be right now. So do you think it's safe for the mothers to get it during the whole situation?
So to the hospital. So you can have only one attendant. You can have only one. People are not allowed to come because anybody who comes can bring in disease, not only for you, but for others as well. And therefore, there will be only one attendant. We don't allow visitors in hospital. So even if a child is admitted, visitors are not allowed. Sorry. We need to protect everybody. Right? So these are things, and this is an excellent question. This is what you need to discuss. A good hospital will not allow attendants to come. So you stay safe, try and minimize contact. Obviously, you can't avoid your pediatrician and your gynecologist. The nurses who deal are all screened. They are all given protective care when they come to you. So you have to learn to protect yourself. So excellent question. Discuss this in advance. You can't deliver anywhere else. You have to go. But most hospitals have separate mother and child areas, which is not. Or if you can go to a birthing center. For example, the hospital that I go to, which is the Rainbow Children's Hospital, which is a standalone, doesn't have adults. So it's only children. There's a separate floor for deliveries and newborns. Nobody else comes in. Sick children can't come in there. When I'm running a vaccination clinic, in my clinic, I won't see anybody else except a child who comes for vaccine. So there have to be separate areas for people who are unwell. I'm not saying that you won't see, but you need to have separate areas for people who are unwell. And they must not be part of where a birthing takes place.
Exactly. So going to like a specific hospital is a better option.
Yes. Yes.
Yeah. All right. So we missed quite a few questions that were asked. Everyone's been saying that your tips were very, very useful to them.
I'm glad.
I am skipping the questions which are not related to COVID-19. All right. So I think we've answered more or less everything. And I'm sorry if I've missed any of the questions. You can send in the question right now. Yeah. So we have almost all the questions answered here. Guys, if there's anything that I might have missed, please send in your question again. And like many offices have reopened now, doctor, and many people have started going out already. So what are the precautions that they can take at home, apart from the usual distancing and taking a bath immediately? Like, are these the only things which suffice?
So carry minimal things when you go to the office. Don't wear jewelry. Don't wear your watch. Okay?
Okay.
Your phone, biggest place where you can pick up things. So just put your phone in a Ziploc so that you can throw that or sanitize it when you come out. Maybe use a Bluetooth so that try and minimize your contact. Don't wear a mask when you're there. Carry your own food. Don't use a lift. If your office is on the 10th floor, take 5 minutes. But walk down. Try being in small places, right? So as I said, carry your own food. Be careful with what clothes you wear. When you come in, make sure these clothes go into hot water and they are sanitized. Don't give your car to the valet person. You don't know what he's got. Try and avoid close contact with other people. At some stage, you will have to go back to work. You can't stay locked down. You know, it's a trade-off between the risks of getting an illness and moving back. Work can't stop. Some things will stop.
Exactly.
So I don't think you'll travel abroad in 2020.
You
may have some local travel, but you can by car instead of traveling by plane. Try and avoid crowded places. Try and avoid a restaurant. Yeah. Try and avoid a barber shop, you know.
These are little things, but they are very, very helpful for everyday life.
There are a lot of people in my family who are volunteering as I'm avoiding. But at some stage, one of them will. Doesn't matter what it looks like. It's fine. Maybe I'll grow a ponytail. So you have to try and prevent. So you have to say, I can get it from XYZ places. and this is how I'm going to prevent it. So what you must try. Yeah.
All right. Thank you, doctor. Dr. Shreya has been asking that her 3.5-year-old was given a flu shot like prior to 9 months back. So is it a good idea to get it done now?
Yes. So, you know, as the new strain for the flu vaccine has come in, the second advantage is that the disease is still under control. If you look at Delhi, where we stay, you're getting an average of about 400 cases a day, right? And remember, these are people who are being tested, who have symptoms. As the lockdown starts easing, there are going to be more and more cases. I would say that let's catch this opportunity. This opportunity may not be there after 1 month or 2 months. There may be many more cases. And then I would definitely stay home. Do it, but do it in a smart and safe manner. Please ask your doctor these questions. So, can I come? Who's going to be in the clinic? Can you give me a dedicated time? Can you ensure that it's going to be as safe as possible? Remember, the doctor's scared himself, right? He doesn't want to get COVID. He doesn't know. The person who's coming, the mother or the other person, is not being screened. So, he's as scared as you are. So, make a smart choice. If it's more than 9 months, finish it off quickly and then sit home for 1 year.
Okay. All right. So I hope you all got your answers, and we are really running short on time, and this will automatically disconnect after an hour. So 32 weeks pregnant Shruti is asking, her doctor hasn't given her a flu shot. Should she take it now?
Yes, she should. Combine it with whichever time she goes for her next visit to the doctor. Please say that I want the flu vaccine in the same visit. You want to minimize going anywhere else.
All right. So all those who've missed the points that Dr. Verma had suggested when you're going for vaccination, what all precautions you should take, you can go through the session again on the Modish Instagram page. The session will be there for the next 24 hours. So for all those who've missed those points there, I hope I haven't missed any other questions. If you have a 5-year-old back home and the mother is visiting the hospital. So the mother has been visiting the hospital and she has a 5-year-old back home. So she's been taking all the necessary precautions, but is it okay if the child still sticks to her?
Well, you know, unless she's a doctor, in which case she obviously needs to be more careful. She should follow the same precautions, that she should be wearing a mask to be sure she can wear gloves when she goes to the hospital. And when she comes back, she takes off outside, goes straight to the toilet, has a bath, puts all her clothes in a bucket of boiling water. Then she should be okay to meet her child.
All right. Thank you so much, Dr. Verma. I have only 1 minute and 50 seconds remaining. And during this duration, I want to really thank you for taking out time from your busy schedule and helping us out with so many questions. I'm really sorry for all those questions that I might have missed during this session. And I'm sure you have helped so, so many people with your guidance.
Great. I'm glad that I had a medium like your Maxine where I could reach out to so many people. You know, we do have these sessions very often amongst medical groups and other groups, but this was a good platform to reach out to a lot of mothers. So I'm glad to help out a few of them.
Yeah, I'm sure you've helped quite a few, and we are going to circulate this video more so that more and more people can get the information that you've provided.
All right. Take care. Nice interaction.
Thank you so much, Doctor. Thank you so much again.
Mothers, you rock. Stay safe.
Yeah. All right. Thank you.
Bye.